No matter where you are, no matter your history, you are welcome here. The scriptures tell us they will come from north and south and east and west, and that talks about the diversity that comes together. And we come to this one community to be expressions of Jesus Christ, because we have said that in our baptism. We've made the proclamation that we are named, we are claimed, we are redeemed, and we are forgiven. So at this worship time, I want you to remember your baptism and give thanks. On behalf of the session of Grocery Hill Presbyterian Church, I bid all of you welcome and ask that you turn to the yellow page, this page, and look at all the announcements, but there are several that just want to highlight. Those who are online, please record your presence for us and send us any notes of joys, concerns with that. So thank you. Those who are here, find the fellowship pads, pass those along. We have a congregational meeting in the service today, so thank you for your attendance to that. And there is a special fellowship hour after the worship as we're going to do some celebrating, which Presbyterians tend to do well.
And you are invited, not just to celebrate Bill's retirement, finally. No, just kidding. I just wanted to say you are invited to help serve. There is a sign-up to sign up and participate in coffee service if you'd like to help and are dying to make your favorite baked good and bring it in. There's a sign-up for coffee service over at the Crossroads. In addition, if you would like to be a greeter or think that you'd like to meet some of the members of the church as they come in and as they depart, there is also a sign-up to participate in greeters at the Crossroads. So please, when you walk by the cards and sign the cards, walk by the greeters and the coffee and sign up for that as well. We would love to have your help. Thank you.
And thank you for wearing your name tags as we greet one another. This is a full day to be here at GIPC. There's even a time for a nap. You have worship, you have the reception. Jim Parker is featured in the musicale at 3 right here. And then when that's all done, let's go and celebrate with the youth. And there's trivia night, a fundraiser. You don't have to be present to donate. The flowers are supplied by Wally Prutcher. Thank you very much. And we do notice that during the Easter season, we light the Paschal candle. So you may have questions about that. But notice. Notice the ways that God is present. Let us worship.
Thank you. Good morning. Please rise in body or in spirit and join me in the call to worship. Did you see that?
What were we supposed to see?
Did you see the miracle of life right before you?
We saw men and women, boys and girls, coming to worship.
Did you see the gracious love expressed in great celebration?
We stand ready to see God's hand in our lives, and we will worship God.
Join me in prayer, praise, and adoration for God's graciousness and love continually offered to us each day. Together we pray.
Gracious
God, miracles and surprises,
we come to worship and sing of your glory.
You have touched this world with your power, your love, and your graces.
We have seen and felt
your hand in our lives. Thank you for your gifts of love and life. When we were wrong, you corrected us.
So we come to sing your praise,
to worship and adore you.
For you are God who gives life and hope and love. All praise and honor and yours
are God.
Through Christ
Jesus, we pray.
Amen. Risen today, hallelujah.
May the peace of Jesus Christ be with you. Share the peace of Christ with one another, with a hug, with a kiss, with a wave to those online, fist bump, whatever expresses peace to you.
We got to turn on our internet. We were so excited.
It's fun.
Oh, yeah. No, it's great. When Amy got the shirt, she goes, I got a shirt for you and a dress for you.
God of light and God of love, we beg you to enlighten our hearts and minds. May we see your love expressed in stories told long ago, and may we see your love in our daily lives. Open us up to your joy and your peace. Through Christ we pray. Amen. Our gospel reading today is from Luke chapter 24, verses 36 and 48. On this third week of Easter, the gospel lesson narrates the third appearance of the resurrected Jesus. Having first appeared to the women at the tomb and then to two disciples on the road to Emmaus, Jesus now, at last, appears to all his gathered disciples. This story takes place on the evening of the first Easter. It is in this final appearance that the central theme that runs throughout Luke's gospel is once again made explicit. Notice Jesus again offering himself for their examination and then claiming them as his witnesses. Listen for the word of God. Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. Yet for all their joy, they were still disbelieving and wondering. And he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish and took it and ate it in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written, that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Can the children come forward, please?
Thank you.
Well, good morning. How's everybody today, okay? The reason I'm not sitting down there with you is that it'd take all six of you to get me back up again, okay? So, who am I? Do you know who I am? Do you know who I am? I'm a person. Yes, that helps. That helps. Well, you see here, I have a badge on, don't I? You can read it from there. What does it say? Susan Hurst, yeah. I'm also Mrs. Hurst. I'm married to that guy over there. And let's see. You know me because you see me around here a lot, don't you? Sometimes, though, when we are asked for identification, so I brought a few things that happen sometimes. When I'm driving a car, what do I have? Driver's license. And sometimes Mr. Hurst and I go traveling, and when we go to the airport, what do I have to have?
Passport.
Yeah, to prove that I'm the person on my ticket and I can fly. That one says I can vote. How about that? And this is from when I graduated from college that said I could do the job that I wanted to do. So that was my identification, if you will. Oh, and look at this. This one's very old. This is my birth certificate. Well, that is a birth certificate. That says I was born, and it says who I am. So, however, if you listen to Mrs. Genter this morning when she was talking, what about Jesus? Do you think he had a driver's license or a passport? Did he have that? No. How did he prove his identity and his authority in the world? While he was living on earth, Jesus did amazing miracles. And he told his disciples about who he was and what he had come to do. Even still, they didn't always believe or understand the things he told them about himself. Even his signs and miracles didn't seem to sink in fully. After Jesus died and came back to life, he came to the disciples again. And even at that point, he had to prove himself. At first, they were so scared to see him. They thought he was a ghost or something. But then Jesus reassured them. He showed them the scars in his hands and feet. He asked for something to eat. Ghosts don't eat food, do they? It was truly Jesus, not a spirit or image of him, but Jesus with a real physical body. He gave them his ID card to prove that he was real and true. Then he reminded the disciples again of all the things he had tried to explain before. It must have seemed to them like the puzzle pieces finally fitting together. Jesus truly did do all that he had promised. He had authority from God, and he was passing that on to them as well. He told them he was sending the promise of the Father to them, and that they would be given power to share the good news of the resurrection. Jesus gave the disciples an important task to spread the love of God to all around them. We have that special task too. We know the truth of Jesus and the power of what he did for us. We have the joy of sharing that with others. That might mean sharing the words of Jesus with other people, or it might just mean caring for them and shining the light of Christ through our joyful attitudes. However we do it, we know that Jesus is with us. He proved who he was through his resurrection, and we carry out his power through love and faith. We recognize and trust his authority now and forever. Can we pray? Dear God, thank you for Jesus. He truly is your son and did all that you promised. Help us to trust in you and recognize your authority in our lives. Thank you for your love. We love you, God, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank
we're continuing to tell a story. Shannon read from Luke, a story of the resurrection. Sue talked about the same story and the revelation of who Jesus is and what is his ID card. How do we know? So Jesus has been raised from the dead in both that passage and in the one I will read. He's appeared to his disciples, ascended into heaven, and has sent the Holy Spirit according to the passages we're reading. Now his disciples began their new lives empowered by God. And so Peter heals a lame man who jumps up and dances. And this is where we pick up the story in Acts. Acts 3, starting at verse 12. Hear the word of God. When Peter saw this, the man jumping who had been lame, he said to them, fellow Israelites, this is Peter preaching, why does this surprise you? Am I reading the same? Why do you stare at us if our own power or godliness we have made this man walk? The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our fathers, has glorified his servant Jesus. You handed him over to be killed, and you disowned him before Pilate, though he had decided to let him go. You disowned the holy and righteous one and asked that a murderer be released to you. You killed the author of life, but God raised him from the dead. We are witnesses of this. We are witnesses of this. By faith in the name of Jesus, this man whom you see and know was made strong. It is Jesus' name and the faith that comes through him that has completely healed him. All that you can see all, as you can all see. Now, fellow Israelites, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did your leaders. But this is how God fulfilled what God had foretold through all the prophets, saying that God's Messiah would suffer. Repent then and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped out, that times of refreshing may come from the Lord. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Did you see that? Did you see that the risen Lord Jesus comes to the disciples and says what? Were you listening? What does he say? Peace be with you. Peace. That's what they've witnessed. Jesus comes in peace. He's been betrayed, arrested, falsely accused and found guilty, tortured, mocked, humiliatedly killed, dead and buried, and he comes in peace. I can imagine these disciples looking at one another asking, did you see that? Is this really happening? This must be a ghost. It's been a long, hard week for Jesus and for his disciples. The night started, the last time Jesus ate was Thursday night with his disciples in the upper room, and this is Sunday night. We don't have any record of him eating between that time, but look, he eats. Did you see that? He again finds solidarity with anyone who hungers. What do you hunger for? I find it interesting that he begins his ministry in the wilderness with the temptations, and what was one of the temptations? Take this stone and make bread so that you, Jesus, the Christ, yes, won't have to be hungry. And Jesus says, I'll be hungry. I'll stand with the hunger. The writer Madeline Langle tells the story of when her daughter was asleep at night and woke up in a panic, having a nightmare and screaming out for a mother. And so what is a mother to do? She runs in to comfort her. And Madeline says she threw a theological term to her, saying, "It's okay, God will be with you." But then the daughter says, "I know, Mommy, but I want someone with skin." You know the hymn that we just sang to the risen Christ, the fourth verse. See, Doug, I did listen to Sunday school. Fourth verse, "May we, Christ's body, walk and serve and stand with the oppressed in this and every land, till all are blessed and can be a blessing be, restored in Christ to true humanity." That we are God's body, the church. Jesus invites his disciples, us, his witnesses, to be his flesh, to be his presence. He announced repentance of forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed to all nations, beginning with where? Do you remember where it says? Jerusalem. Now, what just happened in Jerusalem? Jesus was executed there. Begin there. Begin where you are. Begin right in the danger zone. Did you see that? Repentance and forgiveness right where we are. One commentator wrote, "The culmination of Jesus' words to the disciples, 'You are my witnesses,' is performative language in which the words 'do something.' This scene is the kind of Lucan ordination. He first names and appoints elders and deacons, witnesses. The emphasis is on you. You do something." I love that phrase, and it takes me back to when Anne Marie and I were watching Philip, our middle son, play soccer. He was in the midst of a regional championship game, and it was real exciting, and Anne Marie didn't know the game, but she was into it, and so she said, "Philip, do something." This passage is saying, GIPC, do something. Repentance and new life. Did you see that? So what are you looking for? Why did you come to church today? Why did you tune in to the service? Did you come to receive anything? Did you come to be moved? Did you come to rest? Did you come to celebrate with Bill Jambo? Did you come to be fed? Do you come to be molded into people of the resurrection? What are you looking for? William Sloan Coffin, pastor emeritus of Fifth Avenue Presbyterian Church in New York City and a civil rights activist, said, "It takes courage to be a witness for Jesus Christ. It takes courage to love." The churches could become centers of creative and courageous thinking. Will the church be scared to death or brought to life, he says. It all depends on where we find our ultimate security. And he concludes, "Will it be our own fears or guilt or in God Almighty, of whom we have to ask a thimbleful of help in order to receive an oceanful?" Christ empowers us with the Holy Spirit and commands us to be his witnesses, not passive observers, but dancers and actors in God's plan. We are the flesh of the body of Christ. Now, during our congregational meeting today, you will hear witness of three nominees for elder and eight nominees for deacons. And all 11 of them are testifying of their willingness to stand for election. And they have said, I want to do something. And by the grace of Jesus Christ and the empowerment of the Holy Spirit, they will. We will. Do you see that? For those who have eyes to see, ears to hear, and hearts to receive, and lives to respond. Amen. In response to the word proclaim, I'm asking you to do something. I ask that you stand and say what it is you believe, using the familiar words of the Confession of 1967. They're familiar because those of us who have been in Lauren's class have been studying this rich confession. So together we profess. In Jesus Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself. Jesus Christ is God with humanity. He is the eternal Son of the Father who became man and lived among us to fulfill the work of reconciliation. He is present in the church by the power of the Holy Spirit to continue and complete his mission. This work of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit is the foundation of all confessional statements about God, humanity, and the world. Therefore, the church calls all people to be reconciled to God and to one another. I invite you to sit, unless you're in the choir, to come forward. As the choir is taking their seat, I'm going to call the congregational meeting to order, knowing that the purpose of this is to elect elders and deacons for the class of 2027. We are in order, for there is a quorum, and also to know that the clerk of the session, Sally Freeman, is here and will be the clerk of the congregational meeting. Let us pray. God, through all the ages, you have called people to be reflections of your love and compassion. And we celebrate our Presbyterian polity where elders and deacons come forth to serve you. So as we look at the membership of this congregation and we set aside these two offices, that you may be glorified and you may be served. Through Christ we pray. Amen. In your bulletin, the insert, you will see the names, and I'm going to ask the chair of, she's not here. I'm going to ask the only male who was on the search committee to be here, Gene Swift, to offer the nominations, and you'll hear a little bio, and you'll see a picture of those here. If you are present, you don't have to be present to win, but if you are present when your name is announced, please stand and let us look at to see you. Gene Swift.
Good morning. It is my pleasure this morning to acknowledge this year's nominating committee and thank them for a job well done. Our tenacious leader, Tammy Rank, was incredibly diligent in leading a team that consisted of the following dedicated individuals: Pam Becker, Nancy Colina, Sue Hurst, Doreen Marquardt, Sue Quinn, and myself. It is my pleasure to introduce to you this year's nominees for elder and deacon. The first being, elders, please. Okay, we'll skip to the deacons.
Yeah, start with the deacons.
Okay, and they're not quite in order. All right, so Sophia Bolton has been a member of GIPC for 3.5 years. She's the daughter of Derek and Amy Bolton and the granddaughter of Jan Holmes. Her brother Isaac is a college student. Amy's interests include tennis, golf, reading, and hanging out with her family and friends. At GIPC, she has been involved with a self-study team and GIPC youth. And in high school, she is active in girls, golf, tennis, and the National Honor Society. As a youth, Sophia brings a unique mindset to the role of deacon. Good at problem solving and thinking outside of the box, she has a way of making things happen. Mm-hmm. Sophia won't be serving a 1-year term. Beth Brick has been a member of GIPC for 20 years. She and her husband Jeff have 2 daughters, Melissa and Kelly, and 3 grandchildren. Beth's interests include her bowling league, reading with friends in a book club, scrapbooking, crocheting, and gardening. She has served on the Children's Nurture Commission, was elder of youth nurture, taught Sunday school for children and youth, chaperoned middle and high school mission trips, was a Logos coordinator, and a Sunday morning greeter. Beth has expressed interest in learning new ways to help others and discovering ways that she can help GIPC grow and flourish. The next is Rush Chambers, please. Okay. Russ Chambers has been a member of GIPC for 65 years. He and his wife, Katie, have been married for 40 years. They have 3 grown children, John, Joseph, and Kelly, and 4 grandchildren. In Russ's own words, his favorite pastime is working with his beautiful, talented, and intelligent wife. Few people are aware that Russ was trained by the CIA. relax. His degree is from the Culinary Institute of America. And because of that, Katie has never kicked him out of the kitchen. Russ has served previously as a deacon, and we welcome him back for another term. Doreen Marquardt became a member of GIPC when she and her husband Bruce moved to the island in 2002. They are the proud parents of Alex, a very tall son, and Luna, a spoiled canine. Her interests include music, gardening, golf, and baking. And recently, she boasted that she made some pretty good sourdough bread. Doreen has been a deacon previously and has served on the Children's Nurture Commission. She is currently a member of the Personnel Committee and the Youth Nurture Commission. Most Sundays, you'll see Doreen up front here singing in the choir. And we welcome her musical ability and her positive can-do attitude. Okay, next. Second pew from the front, left-hand side. That's Karen Myron. Karen has been a member of GIPC for 47 years, and she sat right there with her husband, John, every Sunday before he passed. Today, she's sitting with her friend, Bill. Karen's son, Craig, and daughter, Amy, are both married, and Karen is the proud grandmother of a little girl. Outside of church, her favorite activity is attending live musical concerts at Water's Edge and Gros Seal Commons. She's and she's especially fond of classic rock and roll. Besides having previously served as a deacon, Karen has taught Sunday school and helped run the Middler's class. Welcome back, Karen. Okay, Carol Scott is a retired band and orchestra leader, orchestra teacher from Taylor Schools. Originally, she was a member of She was a member of Westminster Church of Detroit, but has attended church with us since 1985. Last Sunday, we welcomed Carol as our most recent member. Carol has been married to Doug, our music director, for 39 years. Besides singing in the choir and accompanying Doug with her flute, she has attended the church flower beds, served on the engagement committee, taught music in Sunday school, and has led the Genesis Choir. Carol's interests include teaching and performing music, gardening, playing in pit orchestras, and browsing in antique shops. Carol is great at brainstorming and organizing, and when it comes to decorating for special events, she has all the stuff. Next is Bud Uday, who's been a member of Gros Seal Church for 50 years. Dr. Bud is a proud U of M graduate, and he retired after a long career as a dentist here on Gros Seal. Bud's interests include powerboating, snow skiing, biking, U of M athletics, and alumni activities, and he also enjoys traveling, home repair and remodeling, playing his trumpet, and has spent time spending time with his grandchildren. Bud has a pretty impressive resume. He has previously been a deacon, was active in adult fellowship, church in the world, church commitment, evangelism, the nominating committee, and property committee, and twice he was a ruling elder. Bud has also participated in mission trips, chaperoned for senior high activities, taught classes in human sexuality and active teen parenting, and was a confirmation class sponsor, played trumpet with a Gabriel brass, and he's a Stephen minister. He never mentioned Coney Boys. We're confident Bud will make a terrific deacon because of his unique willingness to serve others.
Paul Duffett.
Okay.
We don't
have a picture for Paul.
But she's here.
She's here, though. Want to stand up? I'll find you. Here you go. Paula Duffett is a Gros Seal native and was baptized right here at GIPC. She has an MBA, has studied abroad, and has significant leadership skills. She is currently employed as a sales executive with Ford Motor Company. When I approached Paula about becoming a deacon, her love for the Lord and willingness to serve became overly evident. She acknowledges that serving others is an honor, and she is demonstrating that by becoming a deacon for the third time. Her greatest passion lies with Give Love, a mission activity that distributes wooden healing hearts to remind others that they are loved. She suggests this is a way that GIPC could reach out and expand its ministry.
You've heard the nominations for those to be deacon. This is the slate from the nominating committee. Are there any nominations from the floor? Hearing none, I will entertain a motion that we receive the slate of deacons. Is there a second? Support. Any discussion? All in favor say, do something! All opposed say, I'll do it. Motion carries. And now the session, now the elders.
Leah Eagleheart has been a member of GIPC for 36 years. Lee and her husband, Mike, have been married for 40 years. They have a daughter, Grace, and a son, Bud, two grandchildren, and another one on the way. Lee's interests include book clubs, singing, attending the theater, and spending time with her growing family. Mm-hmm. She has been involved in mission stewardship, children's nurture, youth nurture, and the Worship, Sacraments, and Music Commission. She also sings in our choir, and she's the leader of our handbell choir, and she's a Stephen minister. Leah will be elder of Worship, Sacraments, and Music Commission. Thank you, Leah. Bruce Rank has been a member of GIPC for 10 years. He's the husband of Tammy Rank, and along with three sons from a previous marriage, he has three stepchildren and six step-grandchildren. Bruce was employed as the CEO of CFI, a waste management company, and after retirement, he served as a consultant to several other firms. In his spare time, Bruce enjoys reading, fishing, golf, and spending time with his family. He keeps a vintage Vespa motor scooter enshrined in his basement, and he jokingly claims he has no redeeming personal qualities. I wouldn't say that. Bruce has served on the Interim Pastor Search Committee and is currently a co-elder with Kathleen Rankin on the Personnel Committee. He will serve on the Personnel Committee as ruling elder. Okay. Vicki Uday, oh boy. Vicki has been a member of GIPC for 50 years. She and her husband, Bud, have been married for 53 years. They have two children, Christian and Matthew, and are the grandparents of two boys and a girl. Sadly, they lost their son, Matt, of cancer in 2009. For 34 years, Vicki was a speech therapist and special education teacher. She now enjoys reading, knitting, gardening, traveling, bicycling, attending events with friends, and spending time with her family. Vicki has served on the Outreach and Children's Nurture Commissions, has been a confirmation sponsor several times, was elder of both the Adult Nurture Commission and the Worship, Sacraments, and Music Commissions. She's also a Stephen minister. Vicki will be the ruling elder of Mission and Stewardship. Go forth in love, God's good and faithful servants.
There's a nomination from the nominating committee. Are there any nominations from the floor? Hearing none, who wants to make the motion that we receive the slate? There we go, Pam. Is there a support? Yeah. Her husband supports her. Any discussion? All in favor say thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.
All opposed say no. Motion carries. That concludes our business for the congregational meeting. I'd ask that we have a motion to adjourn the meeting to continue worship. There's a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed no. We continue in worship. Thank you very much for the congregational meeting. It's now a time for sharing joys and concerns. As we have a microphone ready to go around, raise your hand, I'll recognize that. Here we go, up here to Yeah. Let's stay with the same microphone. Oh, they're both on. Prayers of joy as Katie Tolly Lauda finished an aggressive six-month cancer treatment program this week. Okay, here we go. Pass it on down. Who's got it? Lucy?
Yes, good morning, Lucy. Before I ask prayers, I just want to tell a little story as a prelude. When my husband Ron was a young boy, he was attending a fair that had the opportunity to win prizes. And he said a prayer. He said, God, if you're up there, please let me win a watch. Well, he did win a watch, but it was a girl's watch. So he says that he learned two things that day. One, there is a God. And two, you have to be specific when you pray. So having said that, I will share my prayer request and ask your specific prayers. On Tuesday, I go to Henry Ford Hospital for a test. It's called, medically, an esophageal echocardiogram, which in layman's terms, they go down your esophagus with a little camera and see what your heart's doing with respect to the mitral valve. And hopefully, they'll find something there that can be fixed. So that's my specific prayer request. Thank you.
Thank you. Others, keep coming forward. Keep coming forward. Ready? Raise your hand. Prayers for Susie, a college roommate of Vicky Uday's, having a mastectomy on Wednesday. Go ahead.
I have a joy. We're expecting a third grandson in September. The Swift name lives on. Did I say great grandson?
Thank you. Who are you going to? All right, Maddie.
Good morning. So I started a new job about a month ago, and one of my coworkers was struggling with breast cancer. And she had her chest removed, and now she's having another surgery on Monday. That's going to be about 10 hours long. Oh. So I pray for her, and I ask for your prayers as well.
Thank you, Maddie. Prayers for all those battling cancer. Prayers for Scott McHugh, that he feels better. Prayers for all who are addicted and anxious or depressed. Prayers for, oh, I got Susie. Prayers also for, the wars going on. Iran, Israel, Palestine, Lebanon, Ukraine, Russia, Nigeria, where the kidnapping of 300 schoolgirls, Australia, the stabbings, the prayers continue. Doreen.
Okay, and our joy, the joy of Bill Jambo and his many years of service as part of the staff of GIPC. And today we are celebrating that. So please join us afterward in the fellowship hall. I hear there's food from TV Diner. I also hear there's cake. But more than anything, there's Bill. And please stop by to say hi, thank you, and wish him well on his way.
Amen, Bill.
You may not have heard that. He said, my family. And your family has put together a card and a little check because we cannot say thanks enough. I've only known you for 18 months, and the way that you have always been whatever needs to be done, and when you just said it, my family. Bill still comes to staff meetings because he wants to know. If I want to know who is this, he not only knows names but histories. He loves you, and you have loved him. So do join us in Fellowship Hall. There is a spread, and I'm going to ask as you leave, go ahead and start eating. And we'll have a blessing, and you'll have an opportunity to share your thanks to him any way you want to roast or commend Bill. But you are a gift from God to this community. You want to say anything?
No, okay. Go on, Lucy.
Please join us. Let us pray. Oh, loving and gracious God, you continue to love us, care for us, surprise us, reveal yourself to us, and we do see you. We see you in Bill Jembo. We see you in those elders and deacons who have said, yes, we want to serve. We see you in the way that we are received here, and we see you as we are encouraged to go out and feed the hungry and to support those who are struggling and to welcome all in. We know that it is a gift from you. And you heard the list of concerns for specific prayers and for general prayers. So thank you for this community that holds us accountable, that encourages us, that forgives us, that walks with us. And in this walk with you, we ask that you receive our prayer, which Christ taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Christ invites us to do something. And during the offertory, I ask you to consider something. And during the offertory, I ask you to consider. How will you respond to God's love?
And loving God, thank you for all the gifts you have given us. We are so blessed and are now responding to your blessing by sharing with others that they may be blessed by our gifts. Multiply the efforts and let your love move over all the earth to your honor and glory. Amen.
Did you see that? Did you hear that? Did you say that? Do something! And as you go and do something, may God bless you with discomfort of the easy answers, the half-truths and the superficial relationships, so that you will live deeply, deeply and from your heart. And may God bless you with anger at injustice, oppression, and the disenfranchisement of people, so that you and I will work for justice, freedom, and peace. And when we do that, may you be blessed with tears to shed with those who are in pain, so much pain of addiction, incarceration, disease, war, famine, loneliness, so that when we reach our hands out to them, we will turn their pain by the gift of the Holy Spirit to joy. And may you be blessed with foolishness. Foolishness to believe and to understand and to trust that you and I can make a difference in this old world by doing the things that others say cannot be done, like going out and doing something for peace, doing something in love, doing something with forgiveness. So with all of God's blessings, go and do something. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.